is kind of a mishmash of a lot of things. It's basically, what are your feet telling you? A lot of people don't know what's normal and what's not. So I kind of wanted to show just an example of how. I don't immediately rush in somewhere. I broke my foot and I immediately knew. I knew what was wrong. And I actually called my mother and she said, well, are you going to the emergency room? I said, well, no, why would I? This is what I do. She was funny. So, but I heard the bones crunch, so I kind of knew that was it. But anyway, what are your feet telling you? So I wanted to show just a lot of different things about the feet. So first of all, just what do our feet do for us? A lot of people are wearing a lot of those exercise step counters now, and the recommendation is to get at least 5,000 steps a day, which is about that's actually a couple miles. 2,000 steps a day is about a mile, and most people that don't do a whole lot do about 2,000 or less steps a day. And so someone who's quite active easily does 10,000 steps a day. So that equates to about over a full lifetime. So we talk about during a lifetime, the average person walks about 250,000 miles. So it's pretty amazing what our feet do for us. When you walk, the ground reactive force, the force that pushes back at you, is equal to your body weight. So when you walk, you're having a lot of force going through your feet. Runners, when you run and you actually pound into the surface, it's 2.5 times your body weight. So if you imagine that kind of weight going through the foot, it's really amazing what our feet do for us. 26 bones, 33 joints, 107 ligaments, and 19 muscles. So pretty complex piece of work. People come to me all the time and say, my arches fell. And I say, well, let's talk about this more because it's more complicated than that. A lot of people have a real high arch. And a lot of people have a real flat foot. You're born with a certain structure that's just you, that's just your structure. It's kind of how much flexibility you have that determines how you actually stand. So a lot of people stand flat-footed their whole life, but they actually have an arch. So if they had an arch support that held them, they would actually hold that arch up. So I always look at what kind of shape do they have overall, and then how flexible they are. Some people have a really high arch like this, and they aren't flexible at all. You can't move those joints at all. That's how they are all. Now, we talk about trying to stretch through our lives and maintain what flexibility we have, but you can't really gain a whole lot. You're not going to change what you were basically born with. So some people tell me that for years they've tried to stand a certain way. Their parents told them to turn their feet in or lift their arch. And that's really difficult to do, and I hate to see people that have done that their whole lives, because then they don't know what's natural for them to do when they stand. But, so normal foot function, there's pronation and supination, just like our hand. Our hand pronates and supinates. It's not just an up and down motion. The ankle joint is up and down, but the subtalar joint, the joint just under the ankle joint, actually goes side to side. So our feet are much more complex than just an up and down motion. So pronation is that this person here is pronated probably a little too much. And over here it shows that there's someone who's supinated, or it's more, again, this is kind of that high arch rigid foot, and they're basically supinated. They're standing on the outsides of their feet. They're going to have certain problems because of that, or they could have certain problems in their life because of that. A person down here that pronates too much, or this one, it could have also different and some of the same types of problems because of that. So because what you're born with and how you function, you can end up with certain problems. This is what we do with orthotics. We actually try to put someone in an orthotic to even them out, to make their weight go up through their leg in a straight line like that, because we'd rather have that than have someone like this, because over here things get stretched out, and over here things get pitched. So that's basically what why a lot of problems occur in the feet. Here's normal, and I see very few people like that. So the common foot complaints. I don't know how many times have you all said this, because I've said it, and a lot of people have said it to me. When your feet hurt, you hurt all over, and that's so true. We take them for granted. We don't think about our feet half the time until they hurt. So the different types of pain, you can have pain in one area versus another. One main thing that I see, one very common thing, is arch pain or heel pain. And arch pain can be due to what I just talked about, someone who pronates a little too much. Now, pronation is normal to a certain extent. With every step we take, when our foot swings through, we're in a supinated position, because the tendons that pull our toes up also invert our foot. So our foot is in a supinated position when it lands on the heel. And that's why most of us wear our shoes out on that outside corner of the heel. Some of us wear them out more than others, but we all wear them out in that area typically. And then once we land, we pronate. And the pronation actually makes the foot more stable. The whole foot comes down on the ground, and because we get a little flatter, it adjusts to uneven surfaces and it keeps us balanced. If we don't pronate, we're going to end up straining our ankles because we're staying on the outsides of our feet too much. So it's normal to pronate while we're walking. And then when we push off again, that same foot pushes off, it has to resupinate, because when the foot is supinated in that position, it makes it more stable, and it's a rigid lever arm that can push off and propulse us. So without being supinated, we can't really propulse well, and we don't move forward very well. So any walker, any runner, we all do these things, and we don't even think about it. But some people pronate a little too much. If your foot pronates a little too much, it stays in that kind of cushiony, flat-footed position too long, and that's where problems can occur. And then when you try to push off again, it has to resupinate, and some tendons sometimes work too hard, joints move too much. So that's the whole basis for a lot of foot pain, is if you pronate too much, or even if you supinate too much. So there's pronation and supination that occurs with every step we take. So with heel pain, arch pain or heel pain, a lot of these things can be attributed to how we walk. Plantar fasciitis, I was going to talk about, because that's the main thing I see. I see so much of this in my office, and it's heel pain. Basically pain under the heel. We also have a lot of things that can hurt around the heel area. Some people have a heel spur in the back of the heel where our Achilles tendon comes in. So that's also heel pain. Tendonitis in the area, there's different tendons that come around that could hurt. Tarsal tunnel syndrome is a nerve pinch, just like carpal tunnel syndrome. It can cause numbness, tingling, shooting pains. And then you can have stress fractures of bumps. So there's a lot of things that can occur in the foot, but because fasciitis is so common, I was going to talk a little bit more about that one. Fasciitis, the plantar fascia is a band of, it's basically like a ligament on the bottom of the foot. It's very tight. And it usually then, if it becomes inflamed or overused, it can hurt, and it's right under that heel. So people will they also call it heel spur syndrome, because you can have a heel spur that develops. But the spur is secondary. The spur isn't what hurts. It's actually the fascia that hurts. So why this occurs is some kind of overuse combined with overpronation. So when you pronate too much and stretch that foot out, and you maybe do yard work 3 days in a row, or you go to an amusement park and walk all day, or your job is standing all day. So overuse combined with overpronation, you can end up with fasciitis. The hallmark of it is that you have pain with the first step in the morning. People get out of bed and go, and they can't walk on it. And then it eases up a little bit, it gets a little better, and then it goes away. Sometimes it doesn't go away. So when it doesn't go away day after day, that's when you need to seek treatment. When we treat these, I do injections, we do arch supports. That's very, very important to stop what's causing it. So I always try to look at what's causing the problem mechanically. Can we treat this mechanically? Can we stop whatever force is causing this? So we use a lot of arch support type things. Physical therapy can help decrease inflammation, increase range of motion. And then there is surgery for this, which most people don't ever need to have. That's a good picture of the fascia. It's basically this tight band of tissue, and there's all muscle bellies under it. And the one thing that doesn't like to stretch is that fascia, so that's why that can become overused. So the other type of pain I see a lot is pain in the ball of the foot. Now the ball of the foot is basically the forefoot, where those metatarsal heads come down and connect with the toes. So things that occur in the ball of the foot, I see a lot of the same things, so I kind of limit those. There can be a lot of other unusual things that go on, but mainly we have neuromas, which is a nerve pinch, and I have one, so I know them very well. Metatarsalgia is basically a term for just pain in the bones. A lot of times when you have excess force on those metatarsal heads, like in that high arch or supinated foot, then you can end up with pain in there, and that's metatarsalgia. You can get just inflamed joints. Some people with arthritis or with something wrong with a joint or just too much force on a joint can have just joint pain. And then again, you can have stress fractures here. So we rule those out with x-rays. And I can usually tell what's wrong by where it hurts and if it swells. So those are things people don't necessarily know at home. But typically, if something in the forefoot hurts more than a few days in a row and it swells, that can be a problem. So you want to seek treatment for that. Anything that swells, we worry about more than if it doesn't swell. But a lot of things really hurt and don't swell too. And if those go on too long, then you want to seek treatment for those. So a neuroma, I do see a lot, and I have one. So it's basically a nerve pinch in between those bones. And again, that's due to overuse. So most of us, there's an overuse component to a lot of these things that we have here. Shoes, foot structure, all those things combined to cause neuroma. Neuroma means nerve tumor, but it's not really a tumor. It can look like one over time. It can kind of get bulky and swollen and big and have a lot of branches to it. So they do kind of look like that, but I don't do surgery on every one of them. If they've been there a long time and we can't treat it other ways, yeah, we do take it out. But a lot of times we try other things first. So what you'll have is pain in the ball of the foot. And what most people say is, yeah, I felt something in my foot. It felt like a rolled up sock or something in my foot. So I took my shoe off and looked at it. And usually we can't see anything. So that's what a neuroma does. It makes you feel like there's something there, but it's not. So what we do to treat them, wire shoes, arch supports. Some pads and shoes that take pressure off that spot can help. I inject them a lot of times. And then we do surgery when they don't get better. So there's a picture of one. It's a nerve that kind of gets enlarged and pinched between those bones. Because every toe has nerves that come from between. The nerve here divides up into that toe and that toe. So this is the nerve that divides up. But right here where it divides, it gets pinched. And it can really hurt. That one can feel a lot like a stress fracture. So they're kind of difficult to tell apart. Typically, though, a stress fracture will swell more than this. And it'll eventually show up on x-rays usually. Most of them do. So other things that people might say is, wow, my foot's changing. I've got a bump. I've got a toe out of position. Something's going on here. I never noticed this bump before. So we call these deformities, some kind of foot deformities. So the ones I see most often and most commonly, bunions, hammer toes, tailor's bunions. So I have pictures of these two in a minute. But a lot of people will see this and say, what is this? What is this, a wart? And it's basically a toe out of position or a hammer toe. And it does affect then the skin and the soft tissue around it, so you can get a corn type of thing on top of it. So that's what people will see, and they don't know what it is. If there's any question to a bump or a bump, have it evaluated, because you can't tell always what it's due to. When I look at something like this, I pretty much know it's due to that hammer toe. But if it had some signs of a melanoma, that could be, you know, something in the skin too. So bunions, hammer toes, and tailor's bunions. So our toes are meant to function a certain way, and over time, if we have some of those things I mentioned, like overpronation or someone that supinates too much, if you've got some muscles pulling harder than others, or in pronation, when you pronate too much, your foot is trying to stabilize. And so what will happen is some of the little muscles that help the toes will actually try to stabilize the foot, and so you end up with a clawing type motion. Certain shoes will do that too. If you're wearing a real loose shoe, like a flip-flop, your toes might try to grip that shoe, and so over time, possibly that could lead to hammer toes because you're causing too much of that gripping. So basically, you don't blame yourself. If you have hammer toes, if you have bunions, it's usually due to your foot structure over time. Whatever shoe you wore as a kid maybe made it worse, like if it was too small of a shoe. It might make it worse, it might make it hurt more, it might make it more symptomatic with corns and blisters. But it didn't cause it. It's typically in your foot structure to begin with. So what you'll have is pain over those bony prominences. Oh, so again, due to foot structure and function, not usually due to your shoes. You'll have pain. You can have pain in on the bump itself. You can have pain inside, deep inside. So sometimes people will feel like a deep ache inside. You might have trouble fitting shoes. Shoes don't fit. They used to because those toes are in a different position now. So what we do is we try different things like padding, those little corn pads or different types of pads to bring them in position, wider, deeper shoes, and then there is surgery to fix them. So here's some pictures. So these are, this type of hammer toe, it's every toe's involved, even the big toe there, it's kind of a position. So that's someone that actually supinates too much because those tendons are constantly pulling up to help them swing through when they're walking, and those tendons, those extensor tendons, are pulling those up. So those are actually extensor hammer toes. There's different types of hammer toes depending on which muscle is involved, but a lot of them do look similar. And that one's starting to get a corn there. You might have pain under here. You might have pain where any of these rub, or you could have pain at the very tip where the tip is hitting the ground. So you can have a lot of symptoms from those type of hammer toes. This is actually a tailor's bunion. So a tailor's bunion, it's from the old tailor that used to sew sitting cross-legged, and so that bump would hit the ground. That's why they call it that. It's someone who was sewing would get a bump like that. But really, what they did didn't cause it. It just made it worse. It made it worse. So it's got the names, you know. This is a bunion, and this is how we evaluate them. So when we talk about fixing bunions, you don't have to fix every bunion, but when a bunion hurts enough to fix, we fix. How we measure these are we measure the angle between the bones, and so we see how big of an angle this is. So the bunion is actually a bump, but it's not just a bump, it's a joint deformity. This joint is basically out of position, that toe's drifting the wrong way there. And then he pushes pressure on that one and he can cause that guy to hammer too. So when a bunion gets big enough that it's causing instability or it's causing a lot of other toe deformities, we fix them. Or if it's painful enough to warrant surgery, we fix them. You don't have to do surgery on every bunion, but we do when they need it. Right, that's it. So then toenail problems. I see a lot of toenail problems. And people come in and they say, I have fungus in my nails. And I say, well, did you test it? How do you know? And so not every toenail problem is fungus, but there is a lot of fungus out there. But whatever the case, people can have thick nails for whatever. An ingrown nail, I see a lot of these, mostly in younger people, but I see it in every age, and a lot of times it's just due to the way their nail grows, and it'll happen over and over and over. Sometimes it's due to them trimming it. If it only happened, if they're 70 years old and it happened once in their life, it's probably due to the way they trimmed it, so we try to just get it to grow back out and start over. But we do little procedures on these a lot. But an ingrown nail is where the border of that nail, the edge of that nail, grows into the skin, so it causes an infection, pain. The shape of the nail, it is usually, again, due to what you're born with. And over time, nails can change. Our nails do change. They do get thicker with time. They can curve on the sides. And then again, fungus. If you do have a fungal infection, that can make the nail change. So there's thick nails are, again, because of damage or several infections or just years of wear and tear. Or if you think of that hammer toe, the hammer toe where the toe's hitting the ground, that's going to cause the nail to thicken over time, too. So. Damage caused the nail to thicken and become brittle, discolored. Fungus can also do that. A fungal infection can also cause them to be thick and ingrown. So we try to differentiate those. We have a new test now where we send the nail away and they tell us what bugs are there. We can tell us in bacteria, fungus, what's there, and then we can treat it that way. Fungal nails are difficult to treat because things just don't absorb into our nails very well. So you can try oral medications, but there's risk to taking oral medicines for that. So I do a lot of topicals, and we usually get pretty good results with them. So here's just some pictures of some. So this one, this isn't just fungus. If you put a topical on there, that's not going to change that. So with things like these, we just try to trim them back, keep them in control. Or we remove them. We actually remove nails sometimes permanently. You don't have to have toenails. Fingernails are important, but toenails aren't that important for us, so we can get rid of them. So when they're this bad, sometimes we just get rid of them. Or I can trim that back and make it look halfway decent, so we do that a lot of times. Here's your ingrown nail with a little infection, so that's kind of what commonly I see. On the toe up, we just clean that out. But sometimes we do permanent corrections, too. If someone has a constant ingrown nail, or I just saw someone today that has a nail, keeps growing in, and we're just going to remove that side. So we just remove that side. We use a little chemical at the root to stop it from growing. So we do that fairly often to keep nails from growing in over and over again. This one I love because I see a lot of these. They actually curl all the way under. So they weren't born with that, but they were born with it more mild than that, and over time it got lower. So So I do see a lot of these. And, you know, when they say trim your, the general advice is to trim your nails straight across. And yeah, that's good advice typically, but something like this, how do you trim this? So I usually tell people, don't, if you have ingrown nails or your nails are hard to trim, sometimes they're just hard to trim, cutting them straight across, you know, you could do your best and you're still not gonna have much success. So in that case, we can do procedures and things for those. Which leads us also to skin. So nails and skin, I see a lot of skin problems in the feet, and some are really difficult to tell what they are. Is there an infection? Is there, what kind of rash is that? So there's some things that are more common than others in the feet. And there are skin cancers in the feet too. We don't think of them, especially podiatrists don't think of them always as often as other things. A lot of times we see a mole and the patient says, oh, I've had that for years, it hasn't changed. Not a bad idea to check those. You know, if they change, yeah, but if you see a dark lesion on the foot, it's probably a good idea to check that. And we do see skin cancers, not that often, but we do see them. The main things, most of the things we see, corns and calluses, I see a lot of those. And corn's another term for like a deep callus or a callus on a toe. So it's basically the same thing, it's thickening the skin. Our body is trying to protect itself. So when there's some kind of force on, say, the bony bump, the skin makes itself thicker. So we've got a great mechanism for protecting ourselves. The problem is, once it gets thick, it can get too thick and it can hurt. So corns and calluses can hurt. So we usually trim those. You know, we like to trim those, or we do it for them, or people that aren't diabetic, don't have a lot of risks, can use a pumice stone and keep calluses and corns down. But we do trim those for people regularly who have risk factors. Warts can look a lot like corns. I see a lot of corns and calluses that can look like warts, so they can be really difficult to tell. Sometimes I can't tell, so we actually have to freeze them, burn them, or send them away for pathology and see what they are. So you can't always tell a wart from a corn. Poral keratosis is another name for a deep corn. So a lot of these they overlap. All these things, when I see something on the bottom of the foot that's deep and hurts, and I say, oh, it could be any other one of these things, so let's look at it and see what it most likely is. So these are things that arise in the skin. We don't even know exactly why. There's debate in this, why these occur. But the consensus for years, we've said, oh, it's a plug sweat gland, and then there's a keratin plug that gets in there. Some people will pick them out, they'll pick them out of their feet, and they come out as a little plug. So we usually call those porokeratoses. I treat those like warts. I trim them, and I do freeze them. I do some of the same treatments for all of these. Then there's rashes. There's a lot of rashes out there. We do see a lot of fungal rashes, athlete's foot, tinea. But you can also have psoriasis, eczema. All these can occur on the foot. So if you have a chronic, if you have a rash that doesn't go away by itself or with an over-the-counter antifungal or just a regular moisturizer, then you probably should have it treated, because those can lead to bigger problems like cellulitis or bigger wounds and things. So infection and cellulitis, these are infections, and these can be problematic. Anytime you have a red, hot, swollen foot, that's you need to seek treatment on that. So that can be an infection. Cellulitis is basically just an infection in soft tissue. So wounds, ulcers, punctures. I do see a lot of people. We always say don't go barefoot, and people still do, and they step on things. Glass, hard to find. When someone comes in the office and they step on glass, I don't always find it. It's tough to find, and sometimes there's a little like a wart or a corn where they stepped on glass, and so it's really difficult to tell. Is it something in their foot? Is it a lesion? It's hard to tell. So some of those things we watch, some of those things we actually numb up and try to find. And so with those things, usually if they hurt, or if they get red, or if they open up and drain, that's the time to seek treatment. Have someone look at that, because it could be a deep infection there. There could be something still there. Blisters. We see a lot of blisters too. So with shoes, we'll talk more about shoes later here, but blisters can be painful, but they can also be very risky in someone that has diabetes or circulation problems. Blisters can lead to open sores and infections and can lead to an amputation. So if you have risk factors for that, we say come in. For if you have a blister, come in if you have those kind of risk factors. So corns and calluses, I kind of mentioned. I see a lot of these, and so I did have a picture here. We can kind of skip ahead here. So differences between them. A corn usually goes in an area where that's rubbing in a shoe. So it's usually a hammer toe or some kind of bony bump that then rubs in a shoe, and that forms a corn. Deep calluses, some people also call these corns, but deep calluses, again, that can look like a wart. So warts are very similar. They can look very similar. Usually I can tell the difference. A wart doesn't always go on a bony bump. So this one, that doesn't correlate to any increased force. Usually a deep corn, will be right where there's one of those metatarsal heads. And so there's increased force there. And that's why people will get those. So warts kind of are willy-nilly. They can go anywhere. But sometimes when there's a lesion right here, I can't always tell if it's wart or callus. So I trim it, and we sometimes will freeze them, but sometimes we treat these in different ways, depending on what we think it is. Again, this is just a callus over a bump. So you can tell this is where they hit in a shoe, where that fifth metatarsal, that's the little toe there. So that's where that rubs in a shoe, and it might be in that high arch foot. So I always look at the foot structure and say, what can we do to stop this? So we trim them, but we also say, well, how do we prevent that? So we'll do maybe an arch support, or maybe a pad, something that will keep it from rubbing. And it should go away then. If you take all the pressure off it, it will go away. So we try to do that with these types of things. There's fungus or athlete's foot in between toes. That's really common there. So I do see a lot of that. Sometimes people have just dry skin. And sometimes it's just dry skin. Sometimes it's a fungal infection. Some people have low-grade fungal infections. They don't know it for years. And they have just dry, flaky skin on the bottom of their feet. So with those, we either test them or we say, go ahead and try an antifungal. When you use an antifungal cream, you have to use it for a full month. It takes about 30 days for the skin to turn over on the bottom of the foot. And so if you use it for a week and it goes away, great. But then it'll usually come back because it's in those deeper layers still. So you want to keep using an antifungal. So anytime if you do say, I'm going to try an antifungal cream to see if this is going to help my dry skin, use it for a full month. And then you also want to take your shoes and spray some Lysol, maybe use some antifungal powder. You want to keep it. Again, I'm always about stop it and then keep it from coming back. So how do we keep it from coming back? Because if you got fungus somewhere, it's you've been wearing shoes for years, you've had that fungal infection for months, it'll come back if we don't do something about it. So we'll spray Lysol on shoes. Or an antifungal. There's antifungal sprays out there, so that's all good. Or you can bleach your shoe, whatever you can do to keep the levels of that down so that you don't reinfect. Nerve syndrome. I see a lot of this. So sometimes people come in with just pain. I have pain here, I have pain there. But some people come in more with nerve symptoms. So nerve pain is more zingers, shooting pain, tingling, burning, numbness, those kind of things. And sometimes they're hard to tell. Some people do have pain they have just dull, achy pain, and they have these zinger shooters. So we have to figure out where their pain is coming from. But the things I see very commonly is peripheral neuropathy, commonly with diabetes, that goes along with diabetes, tingling, numbness, burning, that gets worse with time. And that one's not curable. We can't cure it. So all we do is try to figure out how we live with it and how to not have any problems because of it. Radiculopathy is basically a nerve impingement coming from the back, typically, so something in the lower back. And that one, the difference between that and like a peripheral neuropathy usually is that this one's usually more one-sided, and it can be in a different area, too. Peripheral neuropathy is usually more the big toes, the bottoms of the big toes, symmetrically, both tingly, burning, numb. Radiculopathy is usually more on one side, and a lot of times it's more on the outside of the foot, more on that side. And when they touch it, they can't feel it. They can't find where that pain's coming from. So usually that means it's coming from higher up. It's coming from their back. And nerve impingement, basically the same thing as a radiculopathy, but nerve impingement you can get in other areas too. You can get a nerve impingement like that neuroma. That's basically a nerve impingement too. So you'll have numbness, tingling, burning with that. And that one's in the foot. So when someone comes in, if you have numbness, tingling, burning, it's usually a good idea to have that checked out. Because once that happens, if you can treat it and stop it, if it's an impingement, you can stop it and you can keep from having permanent nerve damage. If your numbness, tingling, burning is just once in a while here and there, it might be the way you're sitting. But if it lasts, if it's there every day, if it gets worse, have that checked out because that's something we don't want to let go. So just to talk a little more about peripheral neuropathy, I see it so much and it basically is why people with diabetes lose their toes. This is why amputations occur. So what happens is there's nerve damage due to some underlying cause. Diabetes is half of all people with neuropathy is diabetes. There's a lot of other causes too. So when we diagnose neuropathy, we want to see why. So we usually want to do some blood tests and things and find out why. But once we know there's a diabetic neuropathy, then we say, how do we keep these people from having amputations? That's the whole thing is prevention. So what I already said, pain, tingling, numbness, gets worse with time, and sometimes it'll affect fingers too. So some people will have neuropathy in their fingers, not everyone. The treatment, again, it's not curable. We We treat the pain. So if people have a lot of pain with it, we treat the pain with medications or topical things or getting up and walking around or doing foot soaks or massage, things like that. So there's a lot of things we can do to treat the pain, but we also need to learn how to protect your feet. So this is what we want to stop from happening. So this is what we saw earlier was one of those calluses, those deep calluses, in someone that doesn't have feeling. If you have that callus and you don't do anything about it, that's what you can end up with, sores in the bottom feet that go all the way through the skin. If that gets infected, you can lose whatever's there. So if it goes right to one of those, to that bone underneath, then you have to go and surgically and take the bone out. So this is what we're trying to prevent. Calluses can actually harm people when you can't feel. If you can't feel pain, you don't know that it's there. People don't know it's there. So switching on to circulation. Circulation and nerve problems can both be very, very difficult. Circulation problems, a lot of people have circulation problems, and it can be either arterial or venous. So the arteries take blood flow to the feet, veins bring it back. So there's a difference between those, and we try to diagnose the difference. Some people have problems with both. So the main things I see are, well, peripheral vascular disease is basically a problem getting blood flow to your feet. So if you don't have the oxygen and the blood going to your toes can become harmed. If you have a sore, it doesn't heal. So we worry about people with circulation problems. It does run in the family, and it does have, there's risk factors there, which I have a slide about. But much of that is preventative. Much of it is smoking. When you smoke, you can have this one much more commonly than other people. This one is actually a picture of Raynaud's disease, and I have it. So I go out in the cold, and my fingers turn white, and they turn just like that, and it's awful. It's an awful feeling. They go numb, they turn white, and it's basically a vasospasm. So it's my arteries, the arteries that are going out to the fingers. When I'm cold, boom, they shut off. And it's something that I have, and I see a lot of people with it. So this is, I always have to deal with this. I always have to stay warm, try to keep my hands warm. So that's circulation problems. It's not the same thing as peripheral vascular disease, but it's a similar effect. You don't have blood flow to the fingers. So if I injure that, that might not heal, so that could be a problem. So then on the vein side, usually venous stasis, varicose veins, problems with your veins usually cause swelling in the legs, varicose veins, and can cause sores too. So peripheral vascular disease, unfortunately, is a big problem when it's severe. This was just an ingrown nail that in someone that doesn't have good blood flow to their toes, that's what can happen, is the tissues don't heal, they die. So you can lose a toe over this. So this is something that can be fixed. We want people to know if something doesn't heal, if it's, you know, if certain color changes in the skin, and I've got risks here coming up. So basically what peripheral vascular disease is obstruction of the arteries. Something's blocking them, and it's usually atherosclerosis. So it's the same thing that we have in the heart when we have heart disease, and we have those arteries that narrow over time. That happens in the feet, and you don't have good blood flow to heal things. What happens first is there's an inflammatory process, and then over time it turns into that plaque in your vessels, and then those can actually be fixed though now. We have a lot of ways to fix those and open those up and bypass those, so it can be treated now. So we usually like to, these can be emergencies. These can be big problems when you don't have good blood flow. So there's a lack of blood supply. One symptom that we talk about is claudication. When someone walks, if someone comes in and says, every time I walk, I get these cramps in my legs, and then I stop and they go away. That's actually claudication. That's a circulation problem. If someone just walks, if they have pain with walking but it doesn't go away, that could be something else. But when we talk about when they're walking, and it's almost always a certain distance. They go one or two blocks and they have to stop because they cramp. And then they stop for a minute and they can keep going. That's a sign of circulation problems. So always have that. Go seek treatment for something like that. Again, changes in your skin, different color, white, black, wounds that don't heal, those can be problems too, so you want to check those out. The risk factors for peripheral vascular disease, smoking, it's the biggest thing we can do to prevent having this. Diabetes, patients with diabetes are at risk of peripheral vascular disease just like they are in the heart. They're at risk of cardiac disease too, so it's something we watch. Their blood flow. That's why I check pulses. When someone comes in, I check, look how their skin looks. I check their pulses. We check their circulation. So nerves are important, but circulation is important too. People with hypertension is one of the risk factors too. being male, being over 50, and being obese are risk factors. And then if you've had a stroke, had a heart attack, I always say, oh, that could mean that you have blockages in your other vessels too. It's not just in your heart. So the treatment, there's, again, stop smoking. There's different medications that can open up vessels. Exercise. When someone has that claudication and they can walk a block, we say keep walking. Walk through the pain, and you'll actually, your body will develop new ways to increase blood flow. So you actually exercise through the pain in that case. So that's something different than other things. If you have, you know, a joint pain or some other things, we want you to stop. But in this case, you actually walk through the pain of this, and it helps. There's procedures, a lot of bypasses, stents, opening up of vessels that can be done. That's our last thing. We don't want to talk about that because that's the last thing. So then on the vein side, I don't know if you've seen this kind of thing. People come in and they have this dark discoloration or they have red discoloration in their lower legs, and that's actually due to veins. So when people swell for a long time, the blood that seeps out into the soft tissues there, they're out of the veins, the blood kind of pools, and it's where it shouldn't be. So that kind of fluid that seeps out isn't good fluid. Somebody mentioned that it's kind of like a swamp water. You think of it, swollen legs, I always think of swamp water. There's swamp water sitting out in the tissues, and what that does is it causes skin problems, rashes, and sores. So we want to get rid of that. So we like to use compression and things to get rid of swelling. We don't want to have swelling long-standing because it'll turn into this, and it'll turn into open sores, just like some of the other things we've talked about. So again, the vein problem, 5% of the population. It's usually the valves in the veins. I've been tested and I have some problems with my valves, so I typically wear a compression stockings because I want to prevent these problems. So compression stockings can help. I stand or I sit all day long, so we're fighting gravity all day long. So I like to wear compression. So I don't know how many times I tell people about this and they say, well, it's too hot in the summer. Well, is it worth not having those problems? So you know, you still want to wear it in the summer. You want to wear pretty the medical grade compression, because you want that to be graduated, that actually helps you. Some of the TED hosen things that they give you in the hospital aren't meant for walking. So you want to make sure you have the right kind of stocking. Some of those aren't graduated. They're the same compression throughout, so they're not actually going to help push that blood up. So you want to have the right kind of stocking. So if in doubt, you know, you should see either a podiatrist or someone that specializes in veins and have that checked out. Again, slow healing wounds, pains, varicose veins, itching. A lot of people have itching with this too. Their leg will itch, and then once you have that swelling and those sores, you're prone to cellulitis. So if you get this hot red area on the leg, then that's definitely, that can be an infection. So we want to treat those with antibiotics and not let that go. So we treat them with antibiotics, but we also talk about compression. So anyone with that, I'll give them antibiotics, but I also do something to compress that fluid out there. And again, the risk factors for this are very similar to the arterial ones too. Family history. I think it's my dad's mother had bad varicose veins, so I'm sure I have her veins. So some of it you can't, you know, just like everything, we can't determine, and we can't choose what problems we have. If you've had a blood clot in the past, you're probably going to have some problems with swelling. Surgery and trauma higher up can cause swelling too. Pregnancy, obesity, and anyone that stands for long periods. Exercise does help. I recommend exercise for every reason, but exercise does help vein problems, especially if you're going on a long trip, you're on a plane, you're in a car. We talk about squeezing your muscles, moving around, taking breaks, trying to get blood flowing. Blood flow is good. Smoking is also a risk factor for veins, so we want to stop smoking no matter what. Phlebitis is inflammation or infection of the veins, and that can lead you to that too. That's something we usually have as again, family history. Right? So the treatment for this, again, exercise, elevate your legs when you can, compression stockings. There are some medications that help. If you're when someone swells, there's a lot of things that can cause it. It's not just your valves and your veins. A lot of times your heart isn't pumping well enough to pump it back. A lot of times if there's a lung problem, the lungs, the blood gets caught in the lungs, and there's a backlog somewhere. So we usually want to find out the cause of swelling, and then we treat it with whatever we can, and typically stocking. So we usually do both of these things. And then there are some procedures, vein strippings and things that you can do to help those veins. Hey, my favorite, shoe gear. So I'm I'm rallying against cute shoes. I can't stand cute shoes because cute shoes are usually bad shoes for our feet. So I just can't even imagine. This just looks to me that's going to hurt no matter what. So your basic shoe that's good is your walking shoe or your athletic shoe because it's meant for being on your feet a lot, for pounding on surfaces, for taking up 2.5 times your body weight when you're running. So running shoes are usually quite good. Now some people with balance problems might have a problem with the tread of those, but there's a lot of different types. So basically something that laces up, something that holds the foot, a good thick sole, are all good types of shoes to wear. This is one. Proper fit. We don't have people that fit shoes as well these days. Some stores still do, but it's hard to get proper fit sometimes when you're just doing it on your own. I always tell people to buy their shoe and then wear it at home first. Don't wear it outside because you can't take it back. So you can always take it back if you wear it in the house for a few days. You want good materials. I like New Balance shoes, and they have a store. They have a couple stores in Salt Lake that fit you. They know what they're doing. They have so many different styles and types of shoes that they fit almost every foot shape. So that's what I like. Some of the brands don't have as many different types of foot shapes that they base their shoes off of. So I like New Balance, and they actually they did a lecture once, and they talked about how their shoes at their store are grade A, and they sell the grade B and C and D to some of these other stores. So if you go to another store and see New Balance, it's not always the same one. And the same with all the brands. They sell cheaper versions of these. So if you see a shoe that's $20 and it should be $100, you get what you pay for. And some of those materials, I compare them side by side, and you can see the difference. I bought some once, and I was really disappointed. They didn't hold up. They didn't feel good. So I'd rather spend the money and have them last and fit for you. And I don't have a lot of shoes. I only have a few pair at any one time that fit me and work well. And then people say, well, do I need an arch support? Well, do you? If you have pain, that's a reason for it. If you have a real high arch or you have a real flat foot, both of those could use arch support. Most people could use arch support and do well with it, but not everyone needs to have it. If you've lived your whole life and you haven't had problems, then you probably don't need it. But there are a lot of people that need them that don't use them. This is something I use in my office. This is just a prefab. So just over-the-counter. The over-the-counter orthotics, there are a lot of the ones in stores are these types that are soft. They're foams, they're soft materials. And they do provide some cushion and the dispersed weight, which a lot of people need. And especially like that high arch that was real rigid, something like that would probably cushion it and be good. If I want to actually control someone, if someone pronates though, this isn't going to stop the pronation. So someone with a real severe flat foot, I do something like this and we mold them and we try to have that actually hold. That's why I use plastic. People say, oh, plastic gets hard, it's going to hurt, isn't it? And I say, no, not if it fits right and you need it. So I evaluate people for that. You're not going to always know when you go to the store what you need. But I like this because it actually supports, it holds, and it works. It's still prefab, so it's cheap. These are $35 that we have in our office. So they work really well for a lot of people. Again, this is like a multi-density, different types. And so you can have soft devices too. A lot of people with diabetes or arthritis or a real flat foot that doesn't. If someone has a flat foot in it and I can't make that arch come up and they've kind of been that way for a lot of years, we use something like that because it just disperses weight better. And it's going to be a little better than something over the counter. So this is more of a custom type thing that we can make too. So it's different than that, and yet it serves its purpose for what it's used for. The general rule is if you have a rigid foot, you use soft materials. If you have a real flexible foot, you use rigid materials. So most of us are in between those. We're not in those categories. So these are all different custom devices. So they're a lot like this basic thing, but they have top covers, they have heel posts, they have some different things added. So we do custom ones in the office, and those cost more than these, but if you need that. So we try these a lot with patients, and if they work, great. If not, if they're not enough, we go to more of a custom device. But again, not everyone needs these, but if you have pain, if you have calluses and things, if you have diabetes and you have numbness, you definitely want something in your shoe. So a shoe alone, most shoes people buy, they say, oh, I have people that come in and say, I have this great shoe, it has arch in it, I don't need anything else. I say, well, think about it. If that shoe is good for you, would it be good for that high arch and that flat foot too? It can't be. It's made for the average foot, so it's made fairly low. So most of the time with a lot of people, especially anyone with a higher arch, I add an arch support to it. So that's it. Keep your feet happy and healthy. So what questions? We don't have much time left, but what
corona fungus?
Yeah.
How do you know you have it? What does it look like? And can it spread to other clothes?
Well, I didn't really show a picture of fungus, did I?
Did you get, and can you get it from gyms or swimming pools, or how do you get it?
Yeah, it is, fungus is everywhere. And when you have a lot of it, it will cause an infection. And what, where it usually comes from is your foot. So if you have a skin infection, you want to treat that because it goes into the nails. So as far as what it looks a lot like some of the damaged nails I showed. You can't always tell the difference. It's thickening, it's discoloration. It'll usually start at the end. So if you see some white or yellow coming in from the end, a little area of your nail that's lifted, and there's some thickness and something wrong with it, that can be a fungal infection.
Will it spread to other toes, or does it just stay in the
skin? You know, it doesn't spread from toe to toe as much as it spreads from the skin. A study came out that said that everyone with toenail fungus has to have had a skin infection at some point. So it usually will affect the skin first. So if you think you have a toenail infection, you probably want to get an athlete's foot cream and use it on the skin to prevent it from getting worse, and then see about treating the nail. Skin's really easy to treat. Nails aren't so easy to treat. So we have topical, and we have solutions to just measure that. And we, in my office, I do a lot of testing, because I can't, sorry I didn't put a picture of one, but fungus can look just like damage, just a thick, deformed or thickened or yellow nail with that junk underneath it. It could be fungus, but it could also be damage. So once fungus has been there a period of time, it will damage the nail. So sometimes you treat it and it does burn. But we can look for bugs. We can take a sample and send it away and look for bugs now. They have a good idea for that now. So.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Okay. My feet get tired real easily.
Yeah.
So is that my bone?
Is it every day? Is it, what do you mean? She said her feet get tired easily. So
they walk for months.
How long?
It feels like I've been walking for a while, even though I've been up there around.
Just around the house, they start to hurt. So it could be your start. Is it both feet? So a lot of times it's mechanical. It's not tingling, numbness, burning.
Sometimes I get
a
burning.
It could be. See, some symptoms can overlap, but typically when someone says that, they say my feet are tired. Does it go away by? Is it there the next morning, or not? You wake up and you're fine. Nerve type symptoms like neuropathy, it's usually worse when you sit. When you sit down and your feet aren't walking and doing something, it'll sting and burn and it'll hurt more at night. Arch pains and pains from mechanics, from the way your foot is, it'll get worse throughout the day, and it usually gets better by morning too. So you might have a little mechanical thing. And then when it's both feet symmetrically achy, that's probably more a mechanical thing, so maybe an arch support will help. Now, people that go to Disney World and hurt, it happens every time. My feet hurt there too, but it typically goes away the next day. I had someone just recently that said they did a lot of yard work and they did some party stuff, and it wasn't a lot of pains, but they woke up and they didn't have pain that day, but the next morning they woke up and they couldn't walk, and it was swollen. That's usually a stress fracture, something wrong, so we want to protect that. We put that in a boot or a cast or a shoe, we try to protect that. So if you have something like that, don't keep walking on that. But yeah, if you have kind of achy feet by the end of the day, that probably just needs some kind of support. Yes?
Aside from compression socks, does it matter what kind of socks you're buying? How big of a deal are socks?
Oh, that's a good question. So we always talk about people with diabetes or neuropathy. We want them to wear socks. We want socks with a shoe. If you wear a shoe without a sock, you can have sores, blisters, calluses. So there are special diabetic socks, which we recommend, that don't have seams that cut, and they're made out of good cotton type materials. But other than that, I like a thicker sock. It protects more from the shoe. But I'm not shoes and socks. I don't usually say one brand is better than another. If you have a particular problem where you're sweating a lot, or a sock just it feels bad to wear socks, then have that evaluated. There could be something going on there. But I like a lot of different. Do you have a particular one that you? Oh,
no. Sometimes I guess it's dry feet or dry skin or something, but heels, my feet will crack.
Yes,
very
we see that
painful.
The cracked, thick, callousy heels can be painful. They can turn into infections too. So those are more common in the summer. They're barefoot, so I usually see more of that. If you have it all year round and it doesn't go away, it can be sometimes a fungal infection that's causing it. It can be an eczema that's causing it. So there are some things that cause it. We usually say to use a moisturizer, and the greasier the better. Grease for peace. So whatever's greasy, put on at night. Put some saran wrap, even cut a square of saran wrap and put that on your heel and leave it overnight. I do that with cracked fingertips too. I put a Band-Aid with, that's the only time I like a Band-Aid because it holds in moisture. So I put a Band-Aid on my thumb at night when it cracks and put some Neosporin or Vaseline, something really oily. And it usually does well after a couple days of that. Use a pumice stone. Pumice stones are safe to take away dead skin and thick skin. So some people have cracked heels all the time and it just keeps happening. So we say keep using a pumice stone after you bathe when the skin's soft. Use a pumice stone to gently take that off. If it's thicker than you think it should be, then yeah, see if there's something going on there. Sometimes I biopsy them or we test them for, sometimes there's infections that are actually causing them, so.
I know it's painful.
Yeah. Oh, when they split, yeah. So someone comes in and they have that real thick skin and it's split. I usually trim it way, way back and then we put some kind of moisturizer in there and work on it for a while. Yeah, those can be tough to treat. Yes, sir.
I've got pain in my heels and the ball of my foot. The ball of my foot has been swollen at times. And I've had the professional orthotics. I've had orthotics over the counter and nothing ever come.
Oh. Have you had, sometimes one thing causes another. When someone has pain in their heel for a period of time, they walk differently, and they can have pain in other areas. So I see that a lot. Sometimes I'll actually cast someone to just completely take pressure off and start over. Have you had x-rays? So I would evaluate something like that. And so I don't know all your history, but usually we do x-rays. We might test for maybe there's something else causing it. Maybe there's a nerve problem. Maybe there is some kind of arthritis problem. So we usually do a lot of different things to look at that. I have some people with just chronic pain, just pain that doesn't get better. In those cases, you can try. There are some medications that we use for neuropathy that can help chronic pain syndromes like fibromyalgia. So,
I have an autoimmune disease.
What was that?
I have an autoimmune disease.
And that, yeah. So is it being treated?
Yes.
Yeah. Because sometimes I say, well, is it treated well enough? Maybe you could optimize. Maybe there's something else you could add to your treatment to make it better. Your orthotics, are they in good shape? Are they worn out? Are you wearing them in the right shoes? Do they feel good? So
you still need decent shoes, good shoes, expensive shoes with the expensive orthotics. With the, I'm made out of money.
So Medicare does pay. When someone has diabetes and they have neuropathy, they actually pay for shoes. Every year they pay for shoes.
Yeah,
the special. Some insurances, Medicare is the basis, and then some insurances will cover those too because they base their guidelines on what Medicare does. So some of the other insurances do. That chronic pain is a thing all its own, and it can be really hard to
say. Yeah, so I hate getting up this morning. All the time. If I'm sitting if I had been walking and then I sit down for a while and I get back up again, it's like starting over in the morning.
That happens to joints and they just get stiff. I don't have one good recommendation for you, but keep seeking treatment and see what else could maybe be done. I have patients that come in and they say, I have this, I've had it for years, I have rheumatoid arthritis, I have toes that go every which way. This is hurting me right now, and so we'll try to do something for that toe right there. We can't always fix it all, but it sounds like you're not, it sounds like you have more than you should. So there's gotta be something else, Sometimes I'll send people to these pain specialists too, to try to see, can we optimize, can there be something we can do to help your pain all around? So, I'm sorry for it. And I'm sorry, I don't have my glasses down, so I... Yes?
Do you know where I can buy really wide shoes? I mean, like double or triple wide.
That's a good question because, we send people, there's not a whole lot up in this area. We send people to Chandler's a lot, Chandler's in Salt Lake. 15 crosses Highland Road or 2300 East. And they have a lot of different shoes they work with. They do the diabetic type shoes too. And they have one big room that's a sale room. They have things on sale because their shoes aren't cheap. But
different
styles. Yeah, no, these are great. A lot of nurses, people that are on their feet all the time, they have a lot of good styles. They have a lot of the European styles is what I like. European shoes tend to have more a wider forefoot, more depth to them. So if you can't, I've had a few people that say, oh, they don't fit me either, but I like Chandler's a lot. And then New Balance, as far as an athletic shoe, I like New Balance a lot too because they use a lot of different lasts that they build their shoes on. So they don't use just three or four like some of the ones. So they have a lot of, they can usually fit you and they know how to fit it. It's hard to find a place that knows how to fit nowadays.
Striders?
Striders is good too, yeah. So they do, and they'll do gait evaluations, they'll watch you while, yeah.
You said Medicare, well, I don't know if they pay for a health, pays for a neuropathy, if you're a diabetic or neuropathy.
Yeah, patient with diabetes and neuropathy.
Special shoes?
Yeah, they actually, it's called their Medicare shoe bill, so you can Google that. Medicare shoe bill, they cover, you have to have paperwork, so your primary care physician has to do some, and I usually do a prescription, and we do paperwork, and then you have to go to a place that will bill it for you. And they'll make you the shoes, yeah. And they do one pair of shoes, and I think they do three different inserts that you alternate each. When they wear out, you put a new one in.
Where do they sell those at?
Pardon?
Where would they sell those at?
We actually use Barton's and Bountiful.
Bruce
Barton.
Yeah.
We use Bruce Barton. It's called Priority Footwear or Barton's of Bountiful. He will make house calls too. He drives all over the place. He does Salt Lake and up Ogden. He goes everywhere. So I like him. I use him a lot. Some of the other prosthetic places will do it too. So if you ask your physician, right, your primary care physician should know. Should be able to do paperwork.
Medicare what?
Pardon?
You can Google Medicare.
Yeah, do Medicare shoe bill. Shoe bill. That should come up and show you. Yeah. But you can also, you can call Barton and ask how you would get going, because he will come to your house and make molds. Yeah, they make a mold of your foot so that they make the insert based on custom. So it's nice. That's a great benefit. Benefit to having diabetes, right?
Yeah. How often can you go for diabetic foot check? Or nails?
Oh, that's a good question. So with diabetes, I always do yearly exams. So anyone with diabetes should have a yearly foot exam. If they have certain risk problems, certain deformities, neuropathy, we have to come more often. So usually on the first visit, I determine that. I say, what's your risk? How at risk are you to having problems? And what should you do about it? And how often should you be seen? So someone should tell you how often. But if no one's ever told you, then definitely yearly.
Yearly?
Yearly, if not sooner, yeah. Yeah.
Did you get your toenails cut?
So someone that does... So if I see someone and I know they have risk factors, they have some neuropathy, they have difficult nails, they can't reach very well, they may not have the hand strength, then they definitely qualify. So anyone like that. And then there are some people without diabetes too that have circulation problems that need to have regular care done. We have them come in regularly. So insurance determines that, and usually we go by 60 days. So we say, come back in 9 weeks. We have some people that need to come back sooner too, but insurance doesn't cover it, but they still come in and they have to pay for it, but it's worth it. And there's, so yeah, we generally tell people 9 weeks. Most people can do that, go that long.
Where are you located?
Do you have I'm in West Point, so I am just a new Smith's out there on 2000, right off like 300 North. In West Point. There's a new Smith store, and we're right in that area. I got cards up here.
Okay.
Yeah. So I left cards up front. I left some just basic information, tear offs you can take. And I think that's it. We're over time, so you guys can go. If you have any more questions, you can come up.